So the first day really was a discussion about the need to go beyond GDP. GDP, as we all of us hopefully have completely internalized even before we came here, is an inadequate measure of well-being. Well-being is what we're really interested in, and if that's what it is, then GDP is sort of a fairly adequate measure of well-being. It fails to account for losses in the productive base, and therefore it certainly is not a measure of the sustainability of development. Doesn't allow us to think ahead. And so it does tell us something. Of course it's a useful measure, but not necessarily a particularly good indicator of the sustainability of well-being. So then the question is wealth inclusive of natural capital and other types of capital that we might that might be of interest to us? Would this be an adequate measure of well-being, and is it increasing? And as Sarpatha eloquently argued, increases in comprehensive or inclusive wealth certainly reflects improvements in intergenerational welfare. So this is a measure that we can rely on. We want to think ahead, and we want to think in terms of what is coming in the future, and it could be a good indicator of sustainable development. Of course, there are huge challenges that remain in estimating wealth. Estimation of changes in wealth require identifying the shadow prices or the accounting prices, whatever you want to call them, of the different components of wealth. Wealth is not just one thing, it's physical capital, natural capital, human capital. There's a discussion about knowledge, health, all of these issues. So if you have a portfolio of assets, we need to be able to add these up and for these needs the correctly identified shadow prices, and so this remains a challenge when to require valuation and forecasting and more. So we have a solution, but it's not the easiest solution. What this basically suggests to us is that we really need to think hard about new ways of accounting for welfare changes, even as we do them right now. Accounting systems need to reflect contributions from environmental resources, so that's what the whole discussion was about. Then we spent quite a bit of time thinking about the CS Central framework as the global standard for integrating official environmental and economic statistics. It's accepted, it's standardized, it's available. So now it's just the implementation phase, and that's what needs to go forward. And if you are able to do this, the expected outcomes include subsector indicators, which is what you might want to start with, and eventually maybe better aggregate measures of well-being. So that's maybe where you will. I was just having this discussion with Mr. Sharing. That might be where you might head towards later. Then, of course, there is the interest in experimental ecosystems accounts. Ivo talked about moving past even on the experimental ecosystems accounts, and that's really good to hear. But this is a developing agenda. There's lots of difference between what you would do under the CS Central framework and the experimental ecosystems account. But one thing that got clarified for me is it certainly includes the non-commercially traded environmental goods and services. So that's one sort of distinction between the two. So I do understand that it's a little bit more complicated than that. And as I said, this is the developing agenda, and it seems to me that all of us can contribute towards this agenda of how to proceed with experimental ecosystems. That was a large part of what we did again yesterday. But there were other issues that came up. There certainly is the demand out there for better measures of sustainability. There's international demand for sustainability indicators. We see this through all the various initiatives that are ongoing around the world, WAVES, TEED, the Inclusive Wealth Report, and so on. These are, of course, not mutually exclusive, but they do have a different foci. So there's a certain feeling that maybe there's scattered attempts and efforts, and there needs to be some coordinated effort. And perhaps there should be. That's not for me to answer, but what the standardized official statistics can do is they can form the basis of what is required to meet this demand that's out there in various institutions and countries. But there are many things that need to happen. At least at the national level, there's definitely a need to link statistics with policies. I think there's a real need to connect the statistics and the national accounts communities with the research communities. I think there's a real need to proceed along those lines. We've made a good start here, and I hope we can move further. And better communication strategies are required so that people aren't doing their own thing in their own little words, right? So we heard all of this, and I hope I'm summarizing what I heard adequately. Okay, now let's talk about all the country experiences. That's what made this workshop extremely rich. We had so many of you come and talk about what you were doing in your own parts of the world. What is clear is that governments collect a lot of environmental data. It's not that the data does not not exist. Data do exist, and there's a lot out there. It's also clear that the supply of environmental indicators or sort of environmental accounts, to the extent that they exist or can exist, they are able to meet policy needs. I think the Philippines contingent was very eloquent in showing us that, look, we can do all of this. There's a demand here from the policy community, and that can some of these questions can be answered if we have this information. So there's no doubt about sort of the policy use of some of these accounts, though in every specific case, you will have to sort of make that connection. What was also clear by listening to the various country presentations was this supply that exists or has been coming to the forefront has been periodic. It has not been continuous. I'm not even sure it's been incremental. It certainly has been sort of periodic, episodic, if you like. And in response to, perhaps in some cases, internal pressure, and perhaps in some cases, external demand. Is this good or bad? But that's how it's been. And it's been inconsistent, sort of across time and space. And this is in how data are collected. It once, and then you do it 10 years later, maybe 15 years later, you do it in this region, you don't do it in that region, so you can't aggregate. So these are sort of challenges or obvious problems that seem to, that at least occurred to me as I listened to many of these presentations. And then the basic fundamental issue of institutionalizing these efforts over a period of time, which requires interagency coordination. This came across as a huge challenge in many of the country presentations. So sort of in looking at these presentations last night and thinking of sort of, well, if you want to implement the central framework, what are some key issues that need to be addressed? And this is what at least I thought I heard from the various countries: lack of expertise. And I was just again having another conversation. It's not just expertise about, you know, what is the SIA thing? What is this creature? How do we open it up and put it into our own country framework? So there's lack of expertise on that. I think we heard that from Malaysia. Are we doing this correctly? Are we not? There's lack of expertise. But it's also a lack of expertise on what do you mean when you say ecosystem services? You know, what are these? You know, how do we break out our own services? Should we break them up or not? What do you mean? How do we actually do this valuation? How do we write a TOR for valuation and hope that it's an adequate TOR? So there's training for that as well as required. Lack of resources, I mean, the world is budget constrained. So it's just stark reality, and I won't say much more. Lack of coordination amongst agencies, because statistical agencies don't generate their own data, of course. And so one suggestion that seems to be emerging, and partly from the UN, is should you have a coordinating committee? BAIS has done that. They've set up this coordinating committee. I don't know. That's something for you to discuss and see how it works in your own countries. Lack of feedback. Should there be networks of communities of practice that somehow coordinate? Because you want to pilot, and then you want to get some feedback on your pilot to make sure you're doing it right. So that's a question. How do we satisfy that? Champions. Without champions, I think this was really clear for us in the work that was ongoing in India. Without the environment minister saying this has to be done, it would have never proceeded. So I don't know who the stakeholders are in your countries who can be champions for this work, but it's worth thinking about this. It's part of the communication. Feasibility, I think Bill talked about the need to build up sort of time, you know, information over time. So you can't do this now and then forget about it forever and then do something else. So what is feasible in terms of data collection or data aggregation over time? Wider participation and feedback. There was an interesting comment about, you know, crowdsourcing. So I just threw that in there. Going forward with ecosystem accounts. Here there are perhaps even bigger challenges, but hopefully challenges that you are willing to take on because I think they can be addressed. There's the physical side of the story. And I, you know, there's all this discussion about matching spatial and administrative units, and that really needs to be sorted. And there's a lot of work that has to happen with aggregating and scaling up. And then institutional leadership, who will take on this role? Because the statisticians certainly don't know anything about GIS and mapping and, you know, all this stuff that has to happen. So does this sit in the environment ministry, and then is there enough coordination with the statistical people? So these are issues that need to be really thought through here. And then, of course, there is valuation. We dedicated half a day to thinking about how valuation can be done. And it seems like a big challenge, you know. I think I spoke to some of you and said it's still spotty, there's something here, something there, you know, can we really get our hands dirty with this? And I think my own sense, and you know, those of us who've been doing this for a while, for me, for example, well, it can be done, and it has to be done. And we do have the local expertise, fortunately, in our parts of the world to do it. So here we can do something more with what is available locally. So it's less expensive to do, in a way, because we've built up this expertise. So are there methodological challenges? Yes. But let's get our hands dirty. Pilots, absolutely essential. But it's also very clear from Rob's presentation, for example, that numbers matter. We are going to have to deal with this if you want to worry about trade-offs. You just can't do the physical stuff. And so we need to slowly, or at whatever pace that we can, move forward on valuation as well. Finally, I think, yes. So going forward, what is your task for the next hour and a half? You've been very, very patient listening to each other, and now you have a chance to really talk within your country groups. And what we'd like you to do is really take the SIA diagnostic tool as sort of the background that you have. But since this is difficult to address systematically within such a short period of time, we thought maybe there are five questions that you could think of answering. What are one or two priority sectors for which environmental accounts can be developed in your country? Right? What policy needs will you meet with these accounts? We have some papers, by the way, but this is written up, so you don't have to make those. We'll distribute that. What mechanisms can be used for interagency coordination? What, you know, is this a committee? How do you bring the stakeholders together to make sure you get the data consistently over time? What are specific capacity and skill development needs? A lot of you have talked about this. What is it that you need in terms of skill development, training, and so on? What knowledge gaps can be filled with research? What are some research priorities? So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 questions that we'd like you to talk about when you go off into your small groups. The plan is as follows. We thought we'd break this out into 7 groups, with the larger countries having their own groups. That's all right. Philippines, Indonesia, Laos, and I'd like the Chinese to join the Vietnamese because it's a small contingent, will have their own groups. And Anu and Pramila in the back will lead you to smaller rooms around here that you can use before team to have your discussions. I request Myanmar, single person contingent, Malaysia, and perhaps Thailand to get together. If you want to separate and have your own groups, that's also okay, but we thought we could have you sit together and the South Asian countries, there are many smaller groups here, so perhaps Bangladesh and Bhutan, your neighbors, can sit together, and Sri Lanka, Pakistan, and India can work together in small groups. And for those of you who don't have rooms, we only have 4 rooms. The rest of you can just sit in the lounge or sit right around here. The request is when you are in your groups, find a chair very quickly and find a rapporteur very quickly, okay? Have the chair direct traffic and have the rapporteur make notes and be prepared to present when you come back after tea. Okay? We've got 5 questions and you should only spend 15 minutes per question so you can adequately answer all questions.